And welcome to Platter Chatter, the critical show that analyzes and critiques music that's on the cutting edge of today's scene. I'm Scott Goldfine.
And I'm Malissia Simpson, and we want to say good afternoon. We have a great show for you today. We're going to be listening to Heritage, brand new album by Earth, Wind & Fire, and also a brand new solo album by Ernie Isley of the Isley Brothers.
And we're going to finish it all up in a neat package with Joe Satriani in concert, which we caught recently at the Santa Monica Civic.
That's right.
So, starting it off off the top, Earth, Wind, and Fire. This is their second really comeback effort. A couple years ago, they put out Touch the World, which had the hit System of Survival on it. This is a much more full work. It has tremendous flourishes, and they're working with MC Hammer and Sly Stone and the Boys. And it's a theme album, Heritage. Old music, new music, and current music.
Well, they're combining a lot of different elements. They're putting in rap, and a lot of their wonderful melodic sound goes along with that. So we're going to watch a video from them, Earth, Wind, and Fire. And what's the name of it?
It's the talented and single Heritage featuring the Boys.
Here we go. By Earth, Wind, and Fire, their brand new album of the same name. This album, I think, is one of the best things they've done since the Gratitude album, which was back in the 70s.
76. Well, I'm going to hold off on that, but I do kind of agree with you. That track featured the Boys, which is the now famous Motown kids singing group who scored a gold album on their first one. They've only done one album. Next one we're going to listen to is called Want to Be Your Man. That features MC Hammer, who's the rapper who came to great fame the past year out of Oakland with a platinum album, won two American Music Awards, and he's featured here to give Earth, Wind & Fire that contemporary rap meets, you know, the punchy horns and plush harmonies of Earth, Wind & Fire. Let's check out Wanna Be Your Man.
I Want to Be Your Man, my Earth, Wind, and Fire, off of their brand new album called Heritage.
That's right. You're listening to and watching Platter Chatter. This album is, you know, as I said, a theme album. It features the little interludes and stuff that they were famous for in the 70s, although I don't think they're quite as, you know, I don't think the flow is quite as consistent as those albums were in the 70s. Certainly, Earth, Wind, and Fire, this is their 16th album for Columbia Records, and they've had quite a legacy. including hits such as Shining Star, Sing a Song, Serpentine Fire, Fantasy. The list just goes on and on. Grammy Award winning, the seminal, you know, R&B big band of the 70s.
Exactly. They were a big influence back in the 70s. Then, you know, this album, one of the things I like about it is that their harmony is so tight, so perfect, that even if their albums aren't as prolific, maybe musically, as they were then, the harmony is still there. The combination that they use in the song Heritage with the Boys, where they just take their voices, it's almost like listening to an a cappella song, because their voices are so light and so young.
Well, you can definitely tell, there's no doubt who it is. It is really a successful updating of Earth, Wind & Fire's sound, I think, although not as good and not as succinct as their 70s work. It's certainly better than anything they did in the 80s, and I say welcome back, and it's definitely a step above their last album, too. So on our disc rating system, one of four discs, four being best, I give Earth, Wind & Fire's new album, Heritage, a 3.
Well, Scott, as much as I hate agreeing with you, I'm going to give it a 3, too. I think this album is pretty good. I'm looking for new, better things from them, and I think, once again, they're going to be a force in the 90s.
I must say, one track I particularly like on there is called, I think it's called Good Time, and that's the one that features Sly Stone. Somehow they dusted the cobwebs off of Sly, yanked him out of jail or wherever the heck he was, and you know, kept chemicals away from him for long enough for him to record that. And he actually sounds good, and no one quite sounds like Sly. And it's definitely a great marriage of the Sly and Earth, Wind & Fire sounds.
Maybe we'll hear an album from Sly Stone.
I'm going to hold my breath, Melissia.
We're going to go on to a brand new solo album from someone, the name I'm sure you've heard, Isley. This is by a younger brother, Ernie Isley, who started playing with the Isley Brothers back in 1969. You may not know his name, but I'm sure you know that distinctive guitar sound. You can't really miss that.
Right, he started off where you first heard that was on Who's That Lady, with that sizzling guitar sound. Mm-hmm. And he's very distinctive. The Isley Brothers had about eight platinum and gold albums throughout the 70s. Their fusion of funk and rock is unique in the genre, and they're a very enjoyable group. And
Their songs, Who's That Lady,
Fight the Power, goes on and on.
Oh gosh, the list goes on, and that steaming guitar is just, so we're going to listen to it now. We're going to listen to a cut called High Wire off of the title album of the same name. This is Ernie Isley and his solo album, High Wire. Situation is a new one. That's a killer. Ernie Isley, and cut off the title album. It's called High Wire. This song, this album, just, it's so, it has so many different influences. I mean, the guitar, you know, if you heard one strain of Ernie Isley, you know right away who it is. If there was no talking or anything, I think you'd know.
Well, if you heard him at all, his style is very unique. He's not the fastest guitar player in the world, but his style is very unique. And it's also very variable within its own kind of, you know, feeling on this album. You know, he covers, he does ballads, he does blues, he does funk.
Right.
Well, that one was kind of, you know, funky in its own right. Big variety, one of my favorite guitar players.
He's just steaming. Ernie has said that you could stick him in a room with nothing but a guitar, close the door, the rest of the world could just fade away and he'd be very happy.
That's right. Let's go to the next track, which is a little mellower vein. I think this would serve them well if they go with this as the next single. So if anyone's listening, Fare Thee Well, Fair Weathered Friend, Ernie Isley. That looks really good.
Yeah.
Back in studio with Platter Chatter, jamming Ernie Isley, Fare Thee Well for a Weathered Friend is the track we just heard. And, you know, this is a little mellower touch of Ernie. He's got an acoustic guitar solo that comes in the middle of that. That's one thing about this album, boy. If you're a guitar fan, this is a great album for it because he pretty much solos on every song. And some of the songs, I mean, he just solos up into the stratosphere.
Well, there's Back to Square One, which gives a little acoustic guitar similar to Fair Weather Friend. There's also Song for the Muses. I wish that we could have played part of that.
Well, there's so many I'd like to play. I mean, there's one Deal With It, which is a slice of bluesy funk rock that just burns
serious
right off.
Funk.
Serious funk. Yeah, it's pretty incredible. Ernie, one interesting thing about him, you know, he went off into his own group in the early 80s. They called it Isley, Jasper Isley, which featured the three younger members of the Isley Brothers Ensemble from the 70s. Mm-hmm. They had some, you know, moderate success, but what's funny about it is that Ernie has put out the first solo album by any Isley member, and he's the youngest, and he seemed like the most unlikely out of everyone to put out a solo album. And in 1983, he started teaching himself how to play left-handed, a la Jimi Hendrix, who, you know, Jimi Hendrix spent time with the Isleys in the 60s before he got big.
Can you imagine being in a family, a musical family, and watching Jimi Hendrix come through your house, Smokey Robinson, Clyde McFadder, all these people that people saw on TV and screamed about, and they're coming into your house like, you know, like they're just the kids down the block.
I think Ernie has pretty much soaked it all in like a sponge. And on this album, he plays most of the instruments, and he's singing. He never sang before much.
Well, he needs to strengthen his voice a little bit. I think if there's a weak spot on the album at all, it's probably his voice. But
sure,
he's got a nice voice.
But he's very earnest in his delivery. It's just that it needs a little more muscle. So, yeah. Ernie Isley, Highwire, on our disc grading system, 1 of 4 discs, 4 being best. I got to give it a 4. This is going to compete for the top of my year in chart for best album of the year.
4, 4, 4. This is my best album of the year starting out. I'm sure that there'll be other albums out this year that'll probably take great prizes and everything, but I'm telling you, I just can't imagine one being better than this.
And I must say, if you've watched the show at all, there aren't too many instances where we give both give something a 4.
No, not at all.
Yeah.
We went to a concert for a gentleman that we reviewed on the show not too long ago. His name was Joe Satriani. We saw him in concert just recently at the Santa Monica Civic. We're going to run a video of his called
Big Bad Moon. A little boogie rock for you.
Yeah. Joe Satriani.
Right up, see it in the sky. all I see is a light. A big bad moon's looking down on me tonight.
We're back in studio. That was Joe Satriani in the video Big Bad Moon. The one thing I can say about him is that, I mean, there's no doubt he's an extremely talented man. His fingers move, looks like faster than the speed of light. However, he needs to have more presence, I think, on the stage. He doesn't really communicate with his audience. That's one thing I thought that was missing from his concert.
Well, I have to kind of agree with you there. It was interesting the way he came out in kind of a Merlin-like robe, as if he was, you know, the wizard of the guitar, which he certainly is. It was strange the way he came out, and he just kind of came out very, inconspicuously, just kind of waltzed out on stage and proceeded to riff right through three instrumentals without saying a word to the crowd. And then he finally spoke to the crowd, real soft-spoken, through these kind of hokey one-liners at the crowd behind, Tums by the drum. And, I don't feel he really connected with the crowd on a verbal, personal level. Certainly his guitar, his virtuoso guitar playing certainly connected with the crowd and had the packed house, you know, really enjoying the guitar playing on the two-hour show. But I think, listening to the records, you get pretty much as much from Joe Satriani as a live performance.
That's true. Well, it was a good show all in all, though.
It was.
What do you think about the Grammys? Bonnie Raitt's got four nominations here. Four nominations and four Grammys. I think that's amazing. After never having gotten a Grammy before, she wins four.
Well, I guess she's been in the business long enough to reap some rewards now, so maybe the album will even go gold.
Well... Maybe. I think she's really great, and I'm glad to see R&B, their style of R&B, coming back again. I think that says an awful lot about where music is going. We're getting solid, real funk and R&B.
Well, of course, if we're going to talk about the Grammys, I'd rather rip them to shreds, because I think the Grammys are a bunch of crap, basically. I mean,
why do
they,
you
uh, they, you know, they're not, they don't keep up with the times, usually 10 years behind the times. And, you know, if I ever see the Grammys catch up, really what counts is I think, if anything counts, look at the critics' polls around the country.
Well, I will say one thing, is last year they were going to get boycotted because they did not even have a category for rap this year.
No, they had the category, but they didn't televise the... Last year was the first year of the rap category, but they didn't televise the presenting of the award.
Well, this year they gave it to Young MC, and they had a big deal about it, and I have to give them credit for that.
Yeah, but see, by adding a category like rap, we can go and talk about this forever, ring out time, but this is a really heated issue for me. Bringing on categories like rap and heavy metal, okay, on the one hand, it's great to honor and give those people their own niche and they can get awards, but really what it's doing is it's, you know, segregating things because...
yes.
Because that gives them an excuse not to nominate rap or metal in the regular categories. So a rap or metal record, you know, what chance does it have of getting record or song of the year? They say, hey, well, it's got its own category. We'll keep it over there, and it doesn't qualify for record or song of the year. So I think it's bogus. We got to move on. We could talk about this forever. I want everyone out there to stay tuned. We're going to be coming to them every week soon, right?
Yes, next month, as a matter of fact, in March. So we want you to be watching your TV, pay attention to your TV guide. We're going to be showing up soon in your living room, and we would like to hear feedback from you about what you think about the show, who you'd like to see.
Right, right into us. One last note, we caught the Rolling Stones video, 25x5. Excellent, check it out.
Great video. I do like the way they used their old clips, and Mick Jagger really was kind of cute, you know, when he was younger. I don't know what happened to him through the years. It was almost like an overnight change, but, you know, their music lives on and on and on.
Okay.
And I saw when I first started liking them, too. That was kind of interesting. Their music just changed.
Okay, well, thanks for joining us on Platter Chatter. I'm Scott Goldfine.
And I'm Malissia Simpson, and we want to bid you adieu. Have a great year. We'll see you soon.
Keep jamming.
Sure.